Hey, welcome back, Survivalists. Malcolm here, and this is February 27th. I want to give you a quick coronavirus update of where we're at right now. So currently, we are at 82,000 global cases, which is a staggering number. And we're at a little over 2,800 deaths, with 60 cases now in the U.S. So it is quickly spreading in here, especially on the West Coast here. We've got some in the north, some on the east coast as well. So it's definitely spreading to the U.S. Now, there is some good news, and it looks like the rate of growth has kind of slowed down. This is the chart here, the rate of growth. It's kind of hard to say how accurate this chart is. You can see right here that the trend is slowing down compared to before, but it is still consistently growing and getting quicker. And I think these are just the measures that we're putting in to kind of slow the spread. Another update is that we are now on every single continent. For the longest time, I've been saying there hasn't been any cases in Africa. Now we got 2 cases in Africa as well as 1 case in South America. That may not seem like much, 1 case, but keep in mind that this all started with only 1 case in China about 3 months ago. In about 3 months, that 1 case has turned into 82,000 cases. And we've been seeing a large outbreak in countries that we wouldn't really expect. For like Italy, for example, they're up to 528 cases alone just in Italy. And they could actually trace that back to one individual person who was in China. He was like an art dealer or something that he was in China. And Italy actually stopped all direct flights to that Wuhan province in China. So the guy just took an indirect flight and got home to Italy just fine. And from that one individual, they're now up to 528 cases. Iran has also been seeing a really big outbreak as well, which, again, is kind of surprising. You wouldn't think that, but it literally only takes one person. And, you know, a lot of these countries have just not been preparing like they should be. And then South Korea, of course, we're seeing a big that's not South Korea. Here's South Korea. We're seeing pretty big numbers in South Korea as well. And what's really ironic is the president just gave a briefing last night talking about how we are prepared, and he started listing off the countries that are most prepared, and U.S. was one of them, and South Korea was also in like the top 10 most prepared countries, yet they now have the second largest amount of cases out of, you know, the entire world. So even though they were the most prepared and they were taking precautions, it still did not stop that spread in their country. And, you know, unfortunately, I really think that every country is going to look as red as China does right now. It literally only starts with one case. You know, Russia, India, Europe, the U.S., we are all going to look as bad as China does on this map pretty soon. I mean, that's just how this thing's going to go. So I've got a couple of big stories involving the coronavirus I want to jump into today. Fortunately, you can hear that I'm actually pretty sick myself. I'm in Maryland, and luckily we have not had any reported cases of coronavirus in Maryland. However, we all know that this thing has a 2-week incubation period before you show any symptoms, and this is asymptomatic, so you can be contagious during those 2 weeks before you show any symptoms. And originally they're saying that this virus can live outside your body on, let's say, a door handle or a hand railing for 3 days. Now the CDC is saying that it can actually live outside your body for up to 9 days. So 9 days, somebody with no symptoms that maybe was exposed to the coronavirus 1 to 2 weeks ago, touched a hand railing, and then you go and touch that hand railing, touch your face, you can be infected. It's that easy, which is why it has gone from 1 case to 83,000 cases in just about 3 months, which is freaking crazy. So obviously the biggest story is that the U.S. Stock market has been plummeting the last 3 days, maybe a little bit, 3 to 4 days. You can see here it has gone down, just straight down, 12% just this week alone. So why is it dropping? Because we're already seeing those supply chain disruptions that I was talking about 2 weeks ago. Our economy is entirely based off of imports from China, cheap imports from China, and their economy is just totally a mess right now because they've got all these factories that are just shut down and not producing anything because everybody's quarantined. The Chinese government told manufacturers that they could open up their plants as long as they have enough face masks to provide each worker 2 face masks a day, and we are having a huge shortage of face masks right now. That's a limiting factor there, why these plants are not opening up, because they do not have enough face masks to provide to their workers. So the Chinese economy has really been hit hard, And we are going to see that ripple effect here in the U.S. and all over the world, really. The entire world pretty much depends on China for cheap labor. We're seeing those ripple effects starting to take place right now. And there's already a whole bunch of companies that are reporting these issues. You know, Nikon and Canon, all these electronic companies are saying that they do not have the supplies to fulfill orders right now. And, like, you can't buy a new Nikon camera right now, or you can't order, like, the newest one because they don't have enough in stock, and those factories have stopped making them right now. And, you know, everybody's been talking about entering into a potential recession for a while now, and this may be just the catalyst here. You know, we can see that all of the gains for about 3 months, so from about October, November timeframe, all those gains have been completely wiped out in just a few days. And I think it's going to keep on going down, guys. I really think, you know, we've been looking for that one catalyst to impact, to tip us over the edge into a bear market. And this is a pretty damn strong catalyst, if you ask me. And we're not the only ones seeing this impact in our markets. A lot of the other countries are, especially Italy. They said that 50% of their GDP is in that one area. Let me find Italy here. 50% of their GDP comes from this area of Italy, from manufacturing and tourism. So their economy is taking a big hit because they've now quarantined. They brought in their military and are quarantining entire sections of the cities. And, you know, they have armed guards enforcing this quarantine against the residents, and they're not allowed to go to school or go to work or leave their homes. Very well may be the catalyst to a global recession, just like we saw in 2008. And in fact, we have not seen a downward trend this quickly and this much since 2008. That's the last time we've seen a 12% loss that quickly. So I do have a couple other stories. Coronavirus impact the tech industry. Yeah, just like I was saying, there's a lot of tech industries, Nikon and Canon and Sony, obviously, with their cameras. But they are predicting that the smartphone production is projected to decline 12%. Coming up, several fiber optic suppliers are based out of Wuhan, you know, so fiber optic companies, Verizon, Comcast, they're going to be impacted. Video game console manufacturing are going to be impacted. Overall, TrendForce expects smartwatches, laptops, PCs, and smart speakers to see the biggest decline in the in previous forecasts. All these tech companies are absolutely dependent on Chinese imports and Chinese electronics, and all of them, you know, are going to be hit. And when you go back and look at individual stocks, it's the tech companies that are being hit the hardest. They, you know, the overall S&P 500 has dropped 12%. I was looking at like Apple and Facebook and Microsoft, and some of them have been hit 14-16% just in the last few days. So this was a really interesting clip, and it kind of has me concerned. So this is a Republican Senator John Kennedy. So this is not, you know, partisan or anything. This is the Republican Senator giving the director of the Department of Homeland Security hell because he just doesn't know anything about the coronavirus. He was giving him bad information, and he just did not seem prepared when he's briefing these senators. Let me just play this clip for you about how the, you know, how ill-prepared we are in America, and how it does not seem like we're taking this serious. And also, I'm going to play this because later on, Trump is directly contradicting this guy, Department of Homeland Security, as well as the CDC, which is, again, very confusing. So let's just play this clip.
Average since we discovered the virus.
Again, it's under 2%. It was as high as 3. Numbers were recalculated based on reporting
from
China.
Is it between 1.5 and 2?
It's between 1.5 and 2%.
Okay, what's the mortality rate for influenza over the last, say, 10 years in America?
It's also right around that percentage as well. I don't have that offhand, but it's
sure
right
that?
Around 2% as well.
You sure of that?
It's a little bit. Yes, sir.
Okay.
All right. So even the senator was like, 2% mortality rate on influenza. That doesn't sound right. He asked him twice, are you sure of that? And no, that's not the correct. And no, man, the guy got that completely wrong. The mortality rate of influenza, the flu, is 0.1%. So 20 times less deadly than this coronavirus is. So yeah, if you watch that entire exchange between him and the senator, he does seem just very unprepared. He just did not do his research, and he doesn't look like he's taking this very seriously. But he does say that he thinks that the number of cases is going to significantly increase in America. And I just bring that up because Trump is going to later on contradict that. So Trump contradicts a CDC warning of inevitable coronavirus spread in the U.S. So let me just read some quotes here from the CDC. They're saying it's not so much a question of if this will happen anymore, but rather a question of exactly when this will happen. We're asking American public to work with us to prepare in the expectation that this could be really bad. So the CDC is urging us to get prepared for this, right? They're urging us to prep for this. Luckily, if you're a subscriber to this channel, you're probably already prepared for this. You've got some food supplies, you got some hand sanitizer, you're prepared for this. But the CDC is asking the American people to help them get prepared for this. They say, and then last night during Trump's news briefing about this, he says, well, I don't think it's inevitable. Whatever happens, we're totally prepared. And this was after, you know, the stock market has already dropped, I think, 6 to 8 points at that percent at that time. And so obviously he's very concerned that, you know, if you hype this up too much, the market's going to continue to drop. But once again, so he is directly contradicting the leader of the CDC, as well as this guy from the Department of Homeland Security, when he says, I don't think it's inevitable. We have this totally prepared. And he also says we have very few people with it. The people are getting better. They're all getting better. I think the whole situation will start working out. You know, there's another quote from him saying that he thinks all this will be resolved by April. This is just really concerning. I watched that entire news briefing with him last night, and he just did not seem to take it very seriously. He kept comparing it to the flu, you know, and he kept, you know, there's one quote that he said during that news briefing. It was something like, yeah, you know, if you get it, you got, you know, a pretty good chance that you're not going to die from it. But again, just him comparing it to the flu, which has a 0.1% mortality rate, with this up to a 2% mortality rate. And let me just say something here. I am not convinced about that 2% mortality rate. I honestly do think it is much higher. And the reason why, you cannot know what the mortality rate is until everything's said and done. There is really no way to tell. You know, this thing has a 2-week incubation period. So these 2,800 people who are dead right now from this, that means that they were infected 14 days ago. So really, you'd have to go back on this chart and see, you know, how many people were infected 14 days ago, and then compare that number to how many are dead right now to get the exact number of what the mortality rate is. And if you do that, it's closer to like 10% mortality rate. But that's not really accurate either. I mean, the real number you need to know is from the moment that the hospital diagnosed people with having this coronavirus, how long until the average person dies after that? And, you know, we don't know that number. It's not public, at least, because a lot of these numbers are coming out of China. But let's say these 2,800 people, let's say it takes 1 week from when the person gets diagnosed to when they actually pass away. So that means you really need to go back 7 days on this chart. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So really, you had 75,000 people. And let's just do some math here. So if we do 2,810 deaths from 75,000 people, that gives us a 3.7% mortality rate, not that 2% or that 1.5%. And let's say it's even longer than that. Let's say on average from when they get diagnosed and that number gets reported to when they die, it's 2 weeks. You know, then you're looking way back here. And again, you know, that will give you up to a 10% mortality rate. But saying that, you know, right now we have 82,000 people diagnosed and only 2,800 of them have died, that's not accurate, because if nobody else got infected right now, those people who just got infected today and yesterday and the day before, they're still going to die, a big percentage of them. So, yeah, I honestly do think that the mortality rate is probably at least 3%. It could be up to 10%. And even all these numbers are based off of what China is telling us. So we don't know the true mortality rate, but it is definitely a heck of a lot higher than the flu. And that's crazy that Trump just kept comparing it to the flu. All right. And during that news briefing, he also named Mike Pence as the leader of the task force to kind of spearhead this whole thing. So Trump's kind of stepping back. He's letting Mike Pence handle all this. Once again, I mean, that's kind of concerning. He is not taking this as seriously as he could. You know, I know it's an election year for him. I know he loves getting into fights with the politicians and everything. And it kind of seems like that may be his priority right now. And he's letting Pence kind of spearhead this. My concern is that, he may be doing this because he knows it's going to be really bad, and he's looking for an escape goat so that 6 months from now, when we've got several thousand Americans dead, you know, he can say, well, look, Pence obviously failed me, and I'm not going to run with Pence again in 2020. You know, he could do something crazy like that. But he's looking for an escape goat, in my view, and that's why he's not taking the lead on this. That's just my theory anyway. But, yeah, Trump's taking a step back from all this. He's letting Pence kind of spearhead how America is preparing for this. All right, so this is actually really concerning as well. We actually have two kind of big stories here in one. First off, we've got our first case of community transmission. So we have about 60 people in America right now with the coronavirus. All of them have either been out of the country or had direct contact with somebody who's been out of the country until right now. We now have our first case of community transmission, is what they call it, that somebody has the coronavirus and they have no idea how they got it. They don't know anybody's been out of the country. They haven't been out of the country. And again, this goes back to coronavirus being airborne and that you can spread it without showing any symptoms and that this virus can live outside of your body up to 9 days. And that's community transmission. And we have our first case of somebody in California who has been diagnosed with this community transmission. Another really concerning fact is that this patient was in the hospital for several days and they never tested him for the coronavirus. They actually eventually transferred him to another hospital. So they could just be thinking, oh, he's got the flu, you know, we're not gonna take this really seriously. And they just never tested him. They never even considered testing him. And it's actually the CDC who made them test the guy. And sure enough, he turned out positive for coronavirus. So I think this again goes back to, we are not prepared for this. How many cases are we now going to see out of that hospital? Because they never tested him. They never even thought about testing him. You know, a lot of hospitals don't even have the kits or the tools that they need to test patients for the coronavirus. So this is very concerning. And this is the beginning of it, man. This is how it starts. We are going to see a lot more community transmission coming up very soon. And our hospitals obviously are not taking this seriously. They're not very prepared. So this is kind of interesting. It's an article about how the coronavirus is going to affect our schools. So we actually have a guide that was written in 2017, Community Migration Guidelines to Prevent Pandemic Influenza, United States 2017. And it lays out exactly what steps that the government is supposed to take if we have a big pandemic like that. And it says here, in the event of community spread in the United States, so community spread is what I talked about with that last case, that's the very first case of community transmission in the U.S., students will remain 3 feet from each other to reduce the spread of disease. In a worst-case scenario, schools will be closed. So if this continues to get really bad, they may close the schools entirely. Keeping kids 3 feet from each other, that's just unrealistic. That's just not going to happen. And so this is in the event of community transmissions, which we were seeing. So we very well may see schools shut down in California and these other hotbed areas where we have a lot of cases, and eventually maybe across the country, schools shut down. And in fact, the Japan Prime Minister requests closures of all schools until April. So Japan has already taken this step. Japan is already closing all schools in Japan to help mitigate and slow down the spread of this coronavirus in their own country. This may be a step that we may see America take pretty soon. But again, what concerns me is how much Trump is concerned about the stock market. And we know that fear causes the market to drop. People are selling their stocks right now out of fear. And if this United States did close all schools, of course, that's going to kind of freak everybody out. You know, when they do that, you are going to see a drop in the stock market. So the question is, you know, is Trump going to put off that decision in fear that the stock market may take an impact? You know, I hope not, but you just don't know. And let me just go and look at how many cases Japan has. So they're up to 189 cases, and they're already closing all their schools. We're up to 60 cases. So they don't have that many more. We'll have 189 cases probably in 2 weeks. Honestly, at this rate, just a week ago, we had like 15 cases. Now we're up to 60 cases. Literally in like 2 weeks, we're going to have probably more cases than they will in Japan. So at what point are we going to close down our schools? And it's probably going to be at a state level at first. So I could easily see California doing that. closing down their schools first to kind of slow down this transmission. And it may be a pretty big thing. It may be several months, honestly. So moving along, a lot of people are asking, you know, is there a vaccine for the coronavirus? And the answer is, for this strand of the coronavirus, this novel coronavirus, the answer is no, there is not. And the experts who are working on that are saying that we will not have a vaccine for 12 to 18 months. This is how it works. They get a new virus and they need to, it takes time to develop it, right? So that's really concerning, 12 to 18 months. We gone from 1 to 80,000 cases in 3 months. How many cases are we gonna have in 12 to 18 months? We could easily be at over 1 million cases globally before we finally have a vaccine. And then you know they're gonna have shortages of the vaccines as well. And it's probably gonna cost a heck of a lot of money as well to get this vaccine when it first comes out. So we're kind of on our own here. All we can do is try to mitigate and slow this down and try to take preventive measures on our own. So this was really interesting. Several Iranian government officials have the coronavirus. So two members of their parliament, one of the country's top clerics, died on Thursday after he contracted the sickness. Deputy health minister tested positive for COVID-19, the new name for coronavirus, just 24 hours after he tried to downplay the threat of the virus in a press briefing. You know, so let's take a look at, this is crazy. So 245 cases in Iran. What this kind of shows is that, you know, this isn't like a socioeconomic disease, that it's like an STD or something that's infecting a certain class or race of people. You know, these are the wealthiest people in that country, and it is affecting them, and they're getting infected and killing them. And those are probably the most informed people in that country about this, and they're getting infected as well. Like, this is going to impact everybody. You know, what's got me wondering is that we're in an election year right now, so we're going to see large masses of people getting together. We're going to see politicians literally trying to shake everybody's hands. How many selfies did Elizabeth Warren take? You know, there's several thousand selfies Elizabeth Warren took. Like, just imagine that going on in the midst of an outbreak. It's really interesting to see what would happen there. And I mean, it's not unfathomable that some of our politicians could get this infection as well. All right, so Japanese woman reinfected with the coronavirus weeks after initial recovery. So she got it from that Princess cruise ship. She was cured from that, or supposedly, you know, got over it. They couldn't test it anymore. She kept testing her. They couldn't find it in her blood or anything. A few weeks later, she tests positive for it again. It reemerges. And I think this really goes back to us not understanding the virus. That's pretty much a false positive. She was still probably contagious during that time. You know, she probably went back to her family and friends after being quarantined for weeks. Probably hug them and kiss them, say, hey, the doctor said I'm safe. And then a few weeks later, oh, no, you actually still have the coronavirus. And in fact, you've been contagious this entire time. And this goes back to show that we do not understand this virus. We do not have a good grasp on it or good control on it. Another very, very scary, scary fact. All right, so this was published today. 20 countries have confirmed their first case in the past 7 days. So in the past 7 days, 20 new countries. And this just shows like how interconnected our countries are. You know, that's 20 countries that had one person that went to another country and got infected and brought it back to their country. You know, these things don't really stay contained in one region or one country anymore. We're an international planet. You know, if something starts in China, it's going to spread all across the world. There, you know, it's literally in every continent except for Antarctica now. If you guys want to see my other videos about the coronavirus, you can check those out right up here. And if you guys want to stay updated on the coronavirus, I plan on doing these as often as I can, even as I'm getting sick. Hit that subscribe button to stay current on the latest coronavirus news. I wish you guys all the best of luck, and I hope I'm just being paranoid about this.